For this episode of Coffee with Closers, I'm sitting down with Deirdre Breckenridge. She authored 8 books, including her latest one called Answers for Modern Communicators. She's an entrepreneur and an educator who taught PR and communications at many prestigious universities, including NYU and Rutgers. She currently runs her own consulting practice, Pure Performance Communications. Stay tuned for our conversation with Deirdre, where she shares her framework for communications called Feel First.
Thanks for joining us for this episode of Coffee with Closers, where business leaders share insights on how to build businesses from the ground up and best practices for innovating in their industry.
Hey, Deirdre, I'm super excited to have you join me for this episode of Coffee with Closers.
Thank you. It's great to be with you.
Most certainly. And I know every entrepreneur has an amazing story of overcoming obstacles to become an entrepreneur. And I'm sure you have something similar to share. Can you share a little bit about your journey of becoming an entrepreneur?
Yeah, so I didn't really know I was ever going to be an entrepreneur. I always knew that I would be in PR and communications. And it wasn't until I was actually doing PR and marketing for a company, and it was a small company. And the owner would say to me at Memorial Day, he would go down to the beach, the shore, for the entire summer. And he would say, hey, you've got this. You handle everything. You know how to work with the clients. Call me if you need me. And I'll be back after Labor Day. Because in New Jersey, that's a big thing to go down the shore. And I would do that. I handled his business and I worked on the campaigns and the programs. And then I realized, wait a second, I can do that for myself. And I just made a big shift. I remember specifically calling my parents to say, you know what? I think I'm going to create my own business. I want to go off on my own. And they thought I was crazy. They questioned. They said, who in our family is an entrepreneur? And then my dad said, oh, you know what? My grandma was a bootlegger during Prohibition. So she was entrepreneurial. And I must have had that gene or something. And from there, I started my own communications company. It got acquired by a larger company. I stayed with that company for 14 years. Now I have a communications consulting business. And that was the start, not even knowing how much I would love being an entrepreneur.
That's a crazy journey. And obviously you've accomplished a lot in your career. You're a prolific author. You have an 8th book on the way. You have a podcast that you run. You just finished your 300th episode. You're an entrepreneur, like you just shared. A lot of accomplishment under your belt. Of all the things you've accomplished, what would you say the one thing that you're super proud of?
Oh my goodness. So I guess if I think of everything, this last accomplishment was very, very different for me. My husband and I, so I'm a business book author. I've been writing books on public relations, branding, marketing. I started in 1999 with Prentice Hall, and I've always had large publishers to work with. And my husband and I recently just wrote a children's book, and it's called A Whisper from Noel, and it's in honor, in memory of our daughter, my stepdaughter, who passed away about 2 years ago. And I think even though her passing was tragic, the purpose behind it is so strong and moving. It is just one of the most wonderful things that I've ever done. And to do it also with my husband feels really good. And all of the proceeds of the book go to Noel's college, TCNJ, for other outstanding research scholars to do their research and work. So that's probably the biggest accomplishment in my life.
That is an awesome story. And obviously turning a tragedy into something memorable and beautiful, that's just amazing. And we're going to get to some of that in a little bit. But obviously you probably have learned a lot of lessons in the process of building your company. Obviously the first company that you sold, and then now you're building almost a consulting practice. So what's some of the biggest lessons you've learned in the process of becoming an entrepreneur and building a company?
Probably that no matter how much you think you know, you don't know everything, and you have to know when to ask for help. Mm-hmm. And that is, I don't know if it's just something that entrepreneurs hold back where they don't want to ask for help because they feel it might show some kind of a weakness or lack of self-confidence. But when I learned to ask for help with really smart people around me, I saw more growth and opportunity professionally for myself as well as for any company that I've been a part of or my own company. I also think listening is so very important as an entrepreneur, as a leader. If you don't listen, you truly can't solve any issues or problems. And I mean actively listening. And these are just, you would think natural as a business owner or an entrepreneur, but I think we need to put some more into this.
Yeah, and obviously entrepreneurship, especially leadership, is a lonely journey oftentimes. And it's extremely important that you are surrounding yourself with quality people who has good experience and good in, vested interest in your own, your success, to share some of their knowledge and wisdom. And the reason why we're doing these kind of shows is also to, pick the brains of people who've been before us and who had a lot of experience that can benefit someone else from avoid making the same mistakes. So
that's so good, because it's okay to make mistakes. I mean, we are absolutely human and we're meant to make mistakes. It's just making them over and over again when you don't have to. You can learn from others through the experience of others. I've always been, no matter how seasoned you are in business, you need mentors or sponsors around you. You always trust your gut, at the end of the day. But the people around you and their good sense and good judgment, so important.
Most certainly. So now I know, you touched on the book that you just recently published, and you also created a framework called Feel First. And like you just alluded to earlier, it came out of a personal tragedy, which kind of led you to do some research. So can you share our audience a little bit about that story?
Sure. So after Noelle passed away, she was a 24-year-old millennial. And I just wanted to understand what millennials were thinking and feeling. So I set off. I didn't realize it was going to be a research study. I saw it as a passion project, and I wanted to talk to as many millennials as I could. And I asked them the same questions over and over again. How do you show up to your conversations? Are you being authentic? What is a relationship to you? What builds trust? What do you need from the people around you? How do you want to be perceived? And these questions led to so many different stories that millennials shared. And I started to record the data. And after over 100 or so conversations, I stepped back and I saw patterns. And the pattern said that millennials, what they were really, really asking for was for the people around them to face fears, to be open and inclusive. They wanted the people around them to be empathetic. Kindness and caring and understanding truly mattered. They want people to be ethical and to have good judgment through any touch point, wherever they are, in their companies, on social media. And they wanted love. They wanted to see others share the passion and stand up for the cause like they do. Now, I just spelled an acronym. That's FEEL. And that model is something that then turned into really the backbone of my business and training, because I started to think, well, if millennials want FEEL, it's not really just about millennials. Human is FEEL and all those parts. How do you know if you FEEL? So my team and I, we created a test, and it's feelfirst.com, feelfirsttest.com, where you can actually go and get scored. It's 32 questions. The test will assess you in every part of the FEEL model, and then it gives you a score. And depending on how you score, there are exercises for you to do. Because in order to truly build a relationship with somebody else, you have to FEEL first. And you have to understand where you are and kind of grade yourself to up your FEEL so that you can connect on a deeper level and build those genuine relationships.
It's interesting that you say, millennials are probably the generation with the most amount of friends and followers, but they lack what you just described, because they don't have that deeper relationship that you just described, right? Because they may have everything that looks like, the social butterfly life. They have the following, they have the likes and you know, all of those comments and reactions to their post, but it seems as though they're still lacking something. So what was surprising to you from this finding when you did this research?
It's always surprising when you hear the stories and the sadness from other millennials about, especially on social media, you know, feeling depressed and anxious, but yet going out on social media and posing with smiling faces and dressing up and looking a certain way when, in essence, all you wanted to do was crawl in your bed and put covers over your head. There was a story around empathy where one young woman was at a company for more than 3 years working with a team. She had received a team project from her supervisor, and the team split up the project. She had her part. They were all going to come back a week later and present it to the supervisor. And she started to work on her part of the project. And about 3 days in, she was feeling really overwhelmed and anxious. And she didn't realize it, but she had a panic attack. And her boyfriend didn't know what was happening, and he got really scared. So he called 911, and she ends up in the hospital for the weekend. So her project is due on a Tuesday. And she, rather than telling anybody on her team or her supervisor that she was having issues or problems or how she felt or that she was in the hospital, she submitted her part of the project. Clearly she knew it was subpar, but she'd rather do that than let anybody know what happened because she didn't think anyone would care. It wouldn't be met with kindness, and no one would really understand. And that just speaks to a level of, here we all are communicating within our teams, in our companies, or we're out on social media, and there's such a disconnect. And we need to be able to, as leaders, especially with companies, we need to be able to recognize and to help people to feel and to be more vulnerable so that there's more cohesiveness and a trust in the team. Without trust, you don't have anything.
So can you give us some practical examples of how entrepreneurs can use this feel first framework to build genuine relationships?
Yeah, so that's interesting because you can use the framework within your own team. You can take the test as a team, see where the weaknesses are as a team, and then come up with, if I'm working with a company, then it's to come up with a roadmap so that you can address the weaknesses, do exercises, put a plan together so that you can be more trusting and cohesive. But you can also use feel in different ways that you communicate. Take your media interviews. A lot of executives want to be those go-to media experts, right? And sometimes when you're in PR, you or you're on a PR team, an expert will say, well, hey, how come we rolled out with that announcement and we didn't even get any coverage? Nobody wanted to interview me, or I had one interview and that was it. And it really comes down to when you feel through media, it's a connection. It's that real relationship that you're trying to gain with a journalist or a producer or a reporter, where it's not just what you have to say and what you want to share. Feel means you're tapping into others' needs, what the media is looking for, what their constituents are looking for, and you're able to actually pick up on signals, be so present and so aware, and be able to navigate conversations that we've never had before. When you go into an interview, it's not just about your messaging and the news of the day for you. It's the news of the day that's going out around the world. And to be prepared and be open to those conversations and to bring your energy. So feel is also a way to come to the table with media and to have more of the conversations that you want as a business owner and be ready.
And I'm sure that applies not just on the media alone, right? Because you talked about internal relationship within the organization, and obviously public relations side of it, also client-facing relationship too, because if you're trying to help customers, you certainly need to be empathetic.
Absolutely.
About whatever their need that you're trying to solve and not just seeing it as a transaction opportunity.
Right, and that's the feel model is, sure, if you want to just have a one-off transaction, if you want a one-time engagement, this is not the model for you. Because I always say, you'll always be strategic in your communication. It's the strategy that gets you to a point of connection. And at that point, I call it passion potential. When you apply a feel lens and you're facing fears and you're empathetic and you can apply your ethics and good judgment and unleash your love because you're matching somebody else, you have the opportunity to really grow that relationship. That leads to loyalty, advocacy, and bonds over time. And that's what you want with your customers.
Most certainly. And having taken your clients through this framework, what kind of feedback have you received?
So it's interesting. I've had feedback. People have said to me, Deirdre, you've actually always had feel a part of you. It's now just coming out more and it's been crystallized through what happened with Noel. They've said that they're able to find clarity. So the first part of the model, facing your fears, really means stepping out of your own comfort zone. And a lot of them, that's one of those phrases we all say, oh, you have to step out of your comfort zone. But do you know what your comfort zone is? And it's a lot easier to step out and to do it in a way that doesn't feel so overwhelming and scary. Identify your comfort zone, pick what you do well and what you like, and then push the envelope. Push it ever so slightly or push it a lot. But when you see it and you know it and you like it and you want more of it, and then talk to people and then ask for help. And it just makes the process of stepping out, like it's not even really stepping out. It's always been a part of you. Mm-hmm. So they like that. They're finding a lot of clarity in what they do in their brands.
Which brings me to my good segue into my next question, because you just published your 300th podcast. You started this a couple of years back. And in that episode, you talk a little bit about getting out of your comfort zone. And one of the things that you've mentioned is, you know, you prefer being behind the mic more than in front of camera, even though you were a professor, you were on LinkedIn Learning, you've done LinkedIn Learning instruction, all of those things you've done, right? So talk to us a little bit about how were you able to get out of that comfort zone yourself and trying to put into practice this feel framework.
So it's so funny that you bring this up, because here we are and, you know, we can see each other and everybody will see us. So I did go through a period of time where I felt my own agency had a department that was a multimedia department. So doing video, that's different than I see TV. Okay. So I was okay. I was always okay on audio. I mean, audio was easy, or I could take any interview over the phone. And then it was video. And I got used to the produced video, which that's easy too, because it's, you know, you can edit it. But I realized as I was writing books and as I was progressing and speaking more that TV would pop up. And what I started to do with a colleague, with a friend, with a family member, was to hit me with questions that I didn't like to answer. I mean, if you really want to step up your game, it's super easy to answer questions that you know like the back of your hand. So I went about it in a tougher way, and I put myself, I was videotaped and I practiced and I watched myself. And as I did this, I recognized the good things and that I could do it. And I felt like I was on a TV interview and I didn't know what they were going to ask me. And the more I did it led to, I feel like I'm ready. And then I stepped into smaller opportunities, small segments, local segments, or even just interviews after conferences if media were there. And then you kind of step it up a notch. And the more you practice, the better you become. And that feedback is critical. Always be, people say, oh, I don't want to watch myself. I can't bear it. But I watched myself. It was a little painful in the beginning. But the more you do and the more you practice, it works.
Most certainly. And I think it is the process of getting out of your comfort zone, right? And that's the only way. But if you don't do it, you'll never get out of it.
No. And to believe in yourself and to realize you're not perfect. It shouldn't be perfect. You can't be perfect. And that's okay. You know, almost have a sense of humor about it.
Most certainly. And obviously you spent your entire career teaching people about empowered communication and storytelling, and you taught entrepreneurs and business leaders about all of that, and you've written books around it. And obviously, you know, what can entrepreneurs do with storytelling to really build a strong culture within their organizations?
So that's something that you have to think about, because when you're a leader, you want that culture. You want to empower people, inspire, empower. And if you can't communicate that, if you have a vision and you can't communicate that, whether it's visually or through your verbal communication, you're going to have a really tough time. And storytelling is a way to paint a picture, to get people excited, to have them understand, to have them see themselves as a one thing that is so key. If you want to build champions within your own company, then include them and start sharing their stories as well, because they're a part of the building of the company and the vision. And I think the more that you can do this and involve people and have them invested, then not only are you sharing the story, but they're a part of it and they're sharing it too.
Yeah, mostly nonprofits are really good at telling stories and using, you know, real world example to, you know, evoke the emotions that they want. But how can practically businesses, right? I mean, corporations that are mostly perceived as profit-driven companies, how can they really use storytelling? And can you give some practical examples of maybe some companies that are doing that well?
So storytelling, it's funny because people say, well, we're a B2B company, or a bunch of accountants, or, you know, we're architects or a technology company. And I always say, yes, but your people all have a story. You all come together and you're unique. I remember working with a medical center in Florida, and, you know, they wanted to become nationally recognized. So they were very well known within the state of Florida, but to get national recognition is different. And, you know, this was at the beginning of social media, but it's a really good example because they had some of the most well-known doctors that they were attracting, cardiologists, oncologists. And one of the things that we did with them, you know, it's a community, and your doctors, you're all family and you want to feel closer, was to make them human. And we had videos. One of the doctors, for example, would share about his practice, what he did on a daily basis at the hospital. But then you see him playing his guitar and he's singing. And I mean, that's a story in and of itself, how all those doctors, you know, a female doctor and her hobby that she was explaining, they all come together as a family. But the storytelling was so human and so vulnerable and transparent that gave them the recognition that they were looking for. And the power of the story really makes a difference.
Yeah, and if you think about it, even in the corporate world, if you look at, you know, people like Gary Vee or Elon Musk or, you know, even like Richard Branson, right, they opened up their personal life through social platforms, sharing their life experience and creating videos and sharing their thoughts to their customers directly. But if you think about, you know, if you think about companies like, I don't know if I can remember the names of some of the senior leaders at GE or, you know, Boeing or any of those, because those come, you know, they're just executives. You never know who they are and what their life is. But I think it's also being vulnerable in some sense of telling that story of who they are and what they stand for and what their vision for the company is, and basically giving a you know, like almost like their entire life is an open book, not just to their employees, but also to the world, which I think has an important, plays an important part in their business and their success.
I do too. I think there's something very, I'll quote Brené Brown, and, mm-hmm. you know, not directly, but she talks a lot about, you know, this is somebody who was into data and research, but yet the power of being human and the storytelling, when you can open yourself up that way, you're going to have a, you know, data is wonderful and we all rely on it, but that human connection is really going to secure the relationship. And when leaders can do that, I think it makes a difference within the culture of their companies as well. Because going back to the story about the young millennial who didn't want to tell anybody that mm-hmm. she was having issues, that could play out very differently among teams or leaders who, and I think companies are doing it now because of the pandemic, where they start their meetings and it's a little more open talk about what's going on or how you're feeling. When a leader can open up and say that they're not feeling so great, or this is going on, here's what's good, this isn't so good, that sets the stage for somebody else to be able to say, oh my gosh, yeah, this happened to me. And that breaks down some barriers. Another thing about millennials that I noticed within organizations is that if that trust isn't there, if leaders aren't being vulnerable, or their team members aren't vulnerable, then even if you said, oh, hey, I noticed that you were quiet today in the meeting, or do you need help with something? They would just say, no, no, I've got this. It's okay. I'm fine. So it's that level of vulnerable and trust and human that will always make the relationship.
Yeah, and I think the biggest problem I think people have is the fear that someone else might use that vulnerability that you expressed against them sometime in the future, right? And I think that's part of the reason why we're all extremely guarded and don't want to express our feelings or be open about what might be going on behind the scenes in our homes or even within the organization.
Right. I mean, you make a fantastic point there. It's almost, you know, to a point what should be shared and what you may not want to share. But there is a sense of sharing something beyond the we're here to work. You have a job to do. Let's get this done. We need to reach our goals. That is so far on the other end of the spectrum. And then there's the, you know, not everybody can be a Gary V, right? Or an entrepreneur who lays it all out. But there are so many points in between that we can hit that would strike a chord and make somebody feel more comfortable. And I think it's getting to know. The field model is a way to say, what is that level? What is that level of facing fears, being open and inclusive, or being empathetic? There's different levels of empathy, or ethics and good judgment, or love and passion. What is the right level for me so that I can connect and that we can sort of grow together?
Mm-hmm. So obviously, you know, we talked a lot about, you know, you've written books, you're an entrepreneur, you're coaching business leaders, you're running a podcast. There's I don't know where in the world you have time for any of this stuff. But obviously there had to be some way of organizing your time and, you know, having some productivity systems in place. Can you share with our entrepreneurs what are some of the systems you have in place to keep you productive?
Absolutely. So I have a team and I rely on them for so much. When I think about my schedule, I know and have confidence that I can go look at my calendar because I have an assistant and a booking agent for the podcast, and that's turnkey. I have a team for all of my storytelling, and it goes out through different brands. So it's, you know, of course, there's the Women Worldwide brand. There is my brand and all of the books that I'm doing, or my consulting communications business. And they run, it's a fine oil machine. It takes time. Mm-hmm. And I would say, and these are not, so I run a team, but they're all freelancers and people I work with. They're not, I'm kind of a one man show. I do have my business partner, which is my husband, but I put a lot into the investment of the team, the systems, trusting them to build the process. And that's the other thing, entrepreneurs, have some trust in your team members, loosen the reins so they can be creative and create for you. And it just runs very well. And I do also tell everybody, if it's important, then get it on your calendar. And that includes spending time with your family and making time for yourself. Because I live by the calendar, so there's no excuse. My family is very, very important, and my assistant knows there's times blocked off just for family time, no social media, and just being present.
Yeah. Super.
That meditation, by the way, that mm-hmm. I do every morning, that's on my calendar.
If anyone, we should show the feel first framework should be to our family, right? Before we go and show the world how we empathize with them or how we feel for them.
And that's why we wrote the children's book, because values, they start in the home. Feelings. We want parents to explore that with their children.
Yeah, and sometimes I think the reason why they take it out on the public is because they don't have someone to listen to them at home. And it usually kind of manifests itself in some other mediums or in
That's right. places.
Yeah.
I mean, we can catch this early. It takes work. Parents have to be present. They have to be mindful. I know it's hard. We're all working. There's a lot going on in this world. But we're the role models. Our children are watching and picking up signs and signals. And you also want to pick up signals from them, too. And if you're not present and really self-aware, you won't have that opportunity.
Yeah, I think my biggest fans for my show is my three kids. So they watch every episode.
Oh, that's wonderful. Built-in fans. I love
it. That's so true. Any parting wisdom for our audience? I know you shared a lot of nuggets of wisdom here, but any parting wisdom?
I would just say to try to be as present as possible in all of your interactions. In order to do really good storytelling or to build relationships, you have to be aware, know what's going on, and you have to be emotionally intelligent in order to handle the emotions of others around you. So that is feel. And I hope that everybody will feel first, take the test, feelfirsttest.com. And find me on Twitter too. I'm at Dee Breckenridge if you ever have questions.
Awesome. Well, I really, really enjoyed our conversation, and it's extremely practical, some of the wisdom that you shared. And thank you so much for your time, and look forward to staying in connection and touch.
Thank you. Thank you so much. This was great.
Awesome.
This episode of Coffee with Closers is brought to you by OneIMS, a leading digital marketing agency helping businesses win new customers. To request a free marketing ROI audit, please visit oneims.com. If you enjoyed this video, please share it. To make sure you never miss an episode, please subscribe.